In all my time watching anime, I've never truly felt the same connection to a series as I did with Kaiji. Kaiji is one of the most expressive works of art I've ever seen. The entire series is loaded with these dense metaphors and symbolic imagery. From the many utilizations of the art style, metaphors, and hope, the point of Kaiji is to be human. On the surface, Kaiji as a series appears to have been drawn by an inexperienced artist. However, it's clear that this is a stylistic choice upon closer examination. Looking at Nobuyuki Fukumoto, the mangaka's other works, there are definitely times where he's drawn things that are conventionally normal looking for anime. But if he's capable of drawing things normally, why use the bizarre art style in all his series? The point of Kaiji's art style is to exaggerate features in order to evoke emotion. Whenever I look at Kaiji's art style, it sort of reminds me of those semi-humanoid art pieces. Things like The Scream or Picasso's art. These vaguely depict a human that's just a touch off. They enhance the features in order to make the most human aspects come out front and center. These facial expressions are the embodiment of their psyche. How they feel is often shown in their faces. Although looking crude, its art style is successful in evoking emotion that the viewer can understand. Eyes and Kaiji are these giant beady things that accentuate the tears and draw out the humanity in the characters. The features of the eyes have been exaggerated, but the intensity within them has become heightened. One of the more notable features within Fukumoto's artworks are his noses, and within the series, the nose does well in hinting at what the character is like. For instance, Miyoshi has a small nose that fits well with his weaker mentality, while someone like Hyoto has a fat nose with moles on it, making his nose look like it's unable to contain the nastiness in him. As all good character designs, the features highlighted in characters are emblematic of who they are. Because of the art style and nose designs, it amplifies who they are and reveals the humanity in the characters. It lets viewers witness their thoughts and feelings via their facial expressions. If you're looking for the most normal nose in all of Kaiji, look no further than Seiya Ichijo, a pretty boy who uses his charm to appeal to Kaiji before tricking him. Ichijo is a minor part of what I consider Kaiji's meta aspect. The meta aspect of Kaiji focuses on breaking out of the medium it's confined to, and more importantly, on connecting you with Kaiji. Metafiction is where a piece of fiction calls attention to the fact that it is one, and it can do that in many ways, whether it does that by breaking the fourth wall, or doing anything that purposely forces you out of the world of the characters. But why would Kaiji do this? As I said, Kaiji uses its meta-ness to connect with the viewers, especially on a visceral human level. There's a certain line between reality and fiction, and the line is what separates what fiction can do. Fiction can inspire, it can make you smile or cry, but that's about as far as it can go. It might inspire you to take action, but it won't actually make you do it. That's the line. Kaiji as a work of fiction can only rely on inspiration, and it tries to reach you on the deepest level, ignoring all intellect. Kaiji uses meta-ness to connect to you by breaking out of his medium. The narrator for Kaiji is well known, and used oftentimes for memes because of how obtrusive he is. The use of the narrator is less about being knowledgeable, and more about exciting the viewer.
This isn't a narrator, it's a hype man.
As a hype man, the narrator works to emphasize what's already happening. He adds to the scene by making the scene much more intense. And likewise, that's also the point of the Zawas in Kaiji. Zawa is an onomatopoeia that's prevalent in a lot of Fukumoto's works to indicate an uneasiness in the atmosphere. These Zawas are paired with visuals that invade your screen, like katakana seen in manga. These traits in Kaiji are meta in that they call attention to how they're fiction, but the emotions they provide are real. There's something exciting about coming across a Zawa in Kaiji, or hearing the narrator hype you up. Kaiji is a thriller, and these aspects make for some of the greatest and most emotional parts of the series. I sort of feel the uneasiness that Kaiji feels when coming across those Zawas, or feeling that same flaming energy and adrenaline rush when the narrator is hyping me up. The meta aspects are what make Kaiji so cathartic to me when he succeeds. It really feels like I endured his troubles along with him, and it's so satisfying to see the loser I've tagged along with throughout the series was capable of overcoming the odds. And that, after everything I've watched, it inspires me to take action like Kaiji does of his own life. While I've detailed the more obvious meta aspects of Kaiji, they don't exactly show how Kaiji's meta aspect connects to me on a deeper level. first opening for Kaiji is a cover of a song called The Future Is In Our Hands. That cover is done by Kaiji's own voice actor, something that connects Kaiji and the opening together. The start of the OP shows a collection of cards that should look familiar to Kaiji fans. A green and blue hand reaches out for the screen, and then a footprint appears. You can see in lettering Kaiji on the sole. This appears to show that this is Kaiji. As each time a new handprint or footprint is shown, it gets closer to the camera to the point where it's almost intruding into your personal space. And from the sporadic depiction of these hands and feet, it appears as if Kaiji is escaping from the card game that's shown in the background. At another point, there are a bunch of shots that don't really represent Kaiji, but are more like feelings of hopefulness and hopelessness intertwined to show Kaiji in a state of fantasy. Each shot is broken by Kaiji forcing himself onto the screen by pushing the fantasies away. Right about now, you should be questioning what the opening means. The opening is this anthem taking the form of a punk rock song. It speaks to the outcasts and losers in that its lyrics are juvenile. We don't need your rules, we don't need your schools and uniforms. The only thing that matters to us is the truth. Notice how the lyrics tend to unionize the viewers with the opening. It uses words like we and us. Hearing it and reading the lyrics makes me feel like it's losers like me against the world. We weren't born to cry. We weren't born to lose. We weren't born for that. It's quite emblematic of Kaiji as a series. A series about a man who keeps losing, even when he wins. A man that goes against society, facing off against people that have all the power in the world. While all this plays out, the opening has these motifs of Kaiji punching and kicking certain shots out of frame. You can tell that Kaiji's literally fighting to be on screen, attacking the medium that confines him into that screen. But more importantly, there is this part at the end where Kaiji looks into the camera and it dives into his eyes. And shortly after, Kaiji triumphantly pushes the screen to the side and gives the audience a thumbs up. This song that Kaiji sings is not just about him, it's about the viewers as well. One of the first things viewers see when they first get into the anime is the opening, and having the show's opening appeal to those delinquents makes sense. Doing YouTube is difficult for me because getting views isn't up to me. It's up to YouTube at the end of the day. No matter whether I make videos on trendy new anime or classics, nothing works. In truth, it's all dependent on whether the algorithm favors my content. Making videos and making them rank in that sense shows my defiance towards the algorithm on YouTube. Before I started this channel, I worked on plenty of other channels. I've been doing YouTube for a while, and after each failure, I couldn't help but feel stupid at how I could never have one channel stick around. And in that sense, I'd say we're both fighting something. Obviously, this trouble is not near the severity of Kaiji's issues, but I think it does illustrate that I think of myself as a sort of loser. Kaiji is a loser, and let's be real, we've all felt like losers. Nearing the end of the opening, I can't help but feel like there's a connection between me and Kaiji. Both of us are these omnipotent people that have power over the opening. Both of us have felt like losers. And both of us are on an uphill battle with the world. It really feels like after all the struggling, that thumbs up is for me. Looking at Kaiji's success in the opening brings me hope, but it also brings me a sense of dread, that I have to face off against the world as Kaiji does. And especially now with how the world is falling apart, I feel like a sort of survivor myself. There are many meta aspects to this opening, but how it connected to me personally was what led me to love Kaiji. As cringy as this is going to sound, just as a weeb starts falling in love with his body pillow, Kaiji has moved past just a fictional character to me. I look to him as inspiration, that I can also push the screens of my own life to the side and give a thumbs up to the people around me. That kind of inspiration birthed hope into me. Hope is very important in Kaiji, and it's used in almost every aspect. The most obvious way to use hope is to use it as a direct correlation to the future. While hope is used to excite the viewers, a lack of hope can be used to leave viewers defeated. I remember watching episode 8 of Kaiji and getting chills at how amazing one can show a lack of hope. For context, at this point, Furuhata and Ando are freeing Kaiji after he took a fall for them. The scene starts with Kaiji in murky and deep waters, and there he sees his two friends near the lighthouse. As his friends are the saviors for Kaiji at this moment, the attribution of a lighthouse to them implies a brighter future if he could just get saved by them. This lighthouse represents Kaiji's bright future and his refuge. Right before Kaiji reaches out to Furuhata and makes contact, the metaphor stops and we're taken back to reality. As Furuhata is talking to some guards to free Kaiji, Ando pulls him back, and Furuhata understandably questions him.
Dameda.
This twist leaves Kaiji destroyed. And after that, we return to the metaphor where the current pulls Kaiji away from the lighthouse, his saviors, and his refuge. I think this moment appropriately handled the state of Limbo great, and it took away something so ingrained into the DNA of Kaiji, hope. Speaking of hope, episode 1 starts with a shot of Kaiji's wall with the poster that says, "The future is in our hands," a reference to the opening, introducing the meta aspects of Kaiji to the viewers from the start. While Kaiji is betting against these randos, the fate of the match is down to a single card. These words work as a double entendre, as Kaiji's future is literally in his hands, while at the same time, applying to Kaiji in a metaphorical sense later down the road. Throughout the entirety of part 1, Kaiji realizes that his wins can only come from himself. It's a message that tells you to dust yourself off and take that leap of faith, because your future is within your grasp. This is shown in Kaiji's state of mind after Funai betrayed him, or even when Kaiji steals some dude's jewelry to pay his way out of hell. The S-Bar, known as the Ship of Hope, only comes out at night. However, with just a glance, it's obvious the ship is not what it appears to be. With its sleek black color, the ship's design appears to look mundane. However, this is recontextualized because the use of the ship is actually quite nefarious. This Ship of Hope is used for illegal gambling, and only after realizing this, it's understood why the ship looks the way it does. The black in all its scenes and panels show it almost connected to both the water and the sky, and that's because the ship isn't there to sail its passengers to the light. It's meant to sail far enough out where the authorities and sailors can't see the ship. It not only works in a technical sense, but it works well in showing that this ship is a lie, that the hope this ship brought was false. It's a trap. The moment I saw that ship, I knew that Kaiji was in for something, and that his hope was already dimming. In episode 14 of season 1, Kaiji says something that really stuck with me. While crossing a steel beam thousands of feet in the air, each member of Kaiji's party slowly dies off, and Kaiji helplessly looks around for support. A man behind him who has been prevalent in the same bets Kaiji's been in, Ishida, hands Kaiji his little winnings, accepting that he won't make it across. Looking at Ishida, he's been reliant on Kaiji before, and now he looks to him as a true survivor. After much arguing, Kaiji takes Ishida's winnings and promises to return it to his wife and mother. And when Kaiji turns around to bicker with Ishida one more time, he realizes that Ishida fell to his death silently so as not to alarm Kaiji. Ishida left Kaiji thinking his entire life he'd been a burden on others. But what he reminds Kaiji is what affirmed my perception of our loser. When Kaiji continues, he finds the support he was looking for. It was Sahara. By having Sahara by his side, he had someone else pushing him, making him strive for his own life as Sahara was. And that's when things click for Kaiji. Humans are hope. The way Kaiji felt towards Sahara as his hope, Ishida felt for Kaiji. And that leads up to my final major instance of hope. In part 4, Kaiji doesn't gamble. Well, not directly at least. Part 4 of Kaiji is an ideological battle between Kaiji and Kazuya. A battle about human nature. One that believes that all friendships are formed by a superficial bond, that under extreme circumstances, best friends will betray each other. And the other side argues against this, that best friends don't betray each other even when put in dire situations. Let's take a moment to stop and analyze Kaiji society. Kaiji lives in a disgusting world, a world where everyone lies for their own benefit. It's money-driven and it's especially gruesome. Underground overlords gamble and toy with lies for their own amusement. Some find twisted enjoyment in seeing others recoil in pain. And amidst all that, Kaiji stands as a symbol of hope to all the losers. Looking at Chang and Mario's stories from part 4, it explains how they've always wanted to escape their positions and live better lives. To break out of their crippling poverty and live freely. These two represent Kaiji in a way, poor with no prospects and gambling their lives in order to be free. In part 4, chapter 144, Chang says, "I can see the same thoughts and feelings we have on Kaiji's back. If people like us don't take a chance like this, we'll never rise above it. Even if we work for the rest of our lives, all we'll ever have is pocket change. We're trash. We will always be trash." No matter how bad the odds are stacked against him, he has to fight. Kaiji-san is our star of hope. A symbol of hope for us. In a way, the most human aspects found in Kaiji are things only humans can feel. A consciousness to relate humans themselves as symbols of hope. This is why I feel like Kaiji isn't just fictional to me anymore. I see Kaiji just as the characters in his world see him, and that's when everything from the meta-ness clicked in. The same opening that connected with me is the very last song to ever be heard in the Kaiji anime. It plays at the end of Kaiji's triumphant moment in season 2. And funny enough, this triumphant scene is ended with a shot of a paper that says, The future is in our hands. Realize that your wins can only come from yourself. Dust yourself off and take that leap of faith, because the future is within your grasp. That meta opening in Kaiji, I can tell why it meant something to me. It was because, in a way, Kaiji was my symbol of hope too.